Assalamu alaikum everyone, and welcome to a new ATP video. Today we'll be talking about the gram-negative bacteria that have a diplococcus arrangement. Probably the only pathogenic bacteria that have this arrangement is Neisseria. Neisseria has two main important species. The first one is Neisseria meningitidis, and the second one is Neisseria gonorrhea. In this video we'll talk about the first one, Neisseria meningitidis, but first let's start with the shared features between these two species. First of all, they're both gram-negative diplococci, and second of all, they are both oxidase positive. For the lab stuff, Neisseria species grow on chocolate agar, but what is that? Do we actually use chocolate? No, not really. Neisseria species can grow on blood agar, because it's inhibited by some of the elements in the blood agar. However, when we heat the blood agar, these inhibitory elements become inactive and thus Neisseria can grow. This heated blood is in fact the famous chocolate agar. The other medium that we use for Neisseria's growth is Thayer Martin agar, which is selective agar that only allows Neisseria species to grow while inhibiting other organisms from growing. This is also known as VCN agar, referring to the antibiotics used to inhibit the other organisms, which are vancomycin, colistin, and nystatin. Now let's move to the shared virulence factors. First we have pili, which allows attachment to mucosal surfaces. These pili also display antigenic variation, which makes it difficult for our immune system to target, because as you know, they always change their camouflage. Then we have IgA protease, which will cleave IgA antibodies at its hinge point. This facilitates Neisseria survival along the mucosal surfaces, because if you remember, IgA antibodies are found predominantly at the mucosal surfaces. Since Neisseria meningitidis is a gram-negative bacteria, he has the ability of producing endotoxin. But be aware that Neisseria endotoxin is a little bit different than the original one that you already know about. It has a lipooligosaccharide instead of the lipopolysaccharide in the previous examples. You can think of it as an alternative version of the lipopolysaccharide found in other gram-negative bacteria. Lastly, you need to know that patients with C5 to C9 deficiency, also known as terminal complement deficiency, are more susceptible to Neisseria infection because these particular complement proteins are essential to form the MAC, or also known as membrane attack complex, that is usually used to cause bacteriolysis. So when these proteins are deficient, the MAC won't be produced enough, and that will cause them to be more prone to infections. Now let's talk about our main topic today, Neisseria meningitidis. The first unique feature that distinguished Neisseria meningitidis from other Neisseria species is that it's the only one that ferments maltose in addition to glucose, while other Neisseria species ferment glucose only. You can remember that from the M letter in its name. Another differentiating feature is that it has a polysaccharide capsule. This capsule inhibits phagocytosis, and thus it's a very important virulence factor for this particular species, in addition to the other virulence factors that it has. A quick note here is that patients with sickle cell disease, or asplenic patients, asplenic means they don't have a spleen, are more susceptible to get Neisseria meningitidis infection, or any other infection with encapsulated organisms. Now let's discuss the pathogenesis of Neisseria meningitidis infection. First, it spreads by respiratory secretions, like respiratory droplets that come from sneezing, coughing, or kissing. Thus, it spreads more easily in crowds and between people in close quarters, like college dorm residents or military recruits. Neisseria meningitidis colonizes the nasopharynx first, and it uses the pili to attach to the nasopharynx mucous surface, and then it will use the IgA protease to escape IgA antibody. Then, it will use the blood to spread through the entire body, and we call this the hematogenous spreading. At the same time, it will utilize the polysaccharide capsule it has to protect it from phagocytosis, like we mentioned before. Then Neisseria meningitidis will cause two main diseases, meningitis, also known as meningococcal meningitis, and or disseminated meningococcemia. Let's begin with meningitis. Once inside the bloodstream, Neisseria meningitidis preferentially travels to the brain. Then it crosses the blood-CSF barrier and enters the cerebrospinal fluid, or CSF, where it replicates and causes inflammation of the surrounding meninges. Meningitis patient presents with symptoms like headache, fever, neck stiffness, photophobia. Photo means light in Greek, and phobia comes from phobos, or fear, and it means feeling of discomfort in the presence of light. And lastly, phonophobia. Phono comes from sound in Greek, and it means feeling of discomfort in the presence of loud sounds. Now let's talk about disseminated meningococcemia. When Neisseria meningitidis spreads through the blood all over the body, it will release the endotoxin lipooligosaccharide, and this will result in massive inflammatory response that will result in increased capillary permeability and activation of coagulation. When there's extensive coagulation inside the blood vessel throughout the body, we call this condition disseminated intravascular coagulation. Intra means inside and vascular means blood vessel, so inside the vessels. This disseminated coagulation will consume the platelets and results in thrombocytopenia. The thrombocytopenia will result in increased tendency of bleeding because you don't have platelets, and that will happen throughout the body and will present as petechial rash, especially over the trunk and the lower extremities. Lastly, when there is damage to endothelial cells and increased capillary permeability, subsequently this will lead to leakage of blood to the interstitial space, and this will ultimately result in generalized hypovolemia, and clinicians call this hypovolemic shock. Hypo means less, and volemic from volume. Now we'll talk about Waterhouse-Friderichsen syndrome. If the inflammatory response happens in the small blood vessels of the adrenal gland, it will result in endothelial damage and rupture of the blood vessels. The DIC condition will make it harder to form clot properly, because we're using the platelets somewhere else, and this will lead to leakage of blood into the interstitial space of the adrenal gland. This, along with the generalized hyperperfusion, will result in ischemia and necrosis of the adrenal gland, which eventually leads to acute adrenal insufficiency, also known as Addisonian crisis. Okay, I know it's a lot, so let's do a quick recap. Neisseria meningitidis infects a patient through the respiratory secretions. Then Neisseria meningitidis will colonize the nasopharynx. Then it will disseminate hematogenously and release the endotoxin lipooligosaccharide, which will result in massive inflammatory response throughout the entire body. This will lead to increased capillary permeability and activation of coagulation inside the blood vessels. And this will lead to DIC, which will consume the platelets and lead to thrombocytopenia and petechial rash. In addition to that, the increased capillary permeability will lead to the blood leakage throughout the body and lead to generalized hyperperfusion or shock. When all that happens and results in ischemia and necrosis of the adrenal gland, we will have adrenal insufficiency or acute adrenal insufficiency, and we call this condition what? Waterhouse-Friderichsen syndrome. For treatment, we use a third-generation cephalosporin, cefotriaxone, and for the close contacts of the infected patient, we use rifampin as prophylaxis. For prevention, we have a vaccine for certain strains, and these are group
A and C.
The vaccine we use is a purified capsular polysaccharide, which is immunogenic from these strains. Immunogenic means it induces an immune response from the body. However, we don't have a vaccine yet for group B, because type B strain capsule is not immunogenic. So, most of the infections all around the world are caused by type B strain usually. That is all you need to know about Neisseria meningitidis. We hope you enjoyed the video. Please give us your feedback so we can improve in the next videos, and don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to get our new videos and explanations. Thank you.